Okay, this would be the second to last lecture, lecture 17. This is section 10.1 and 10.3. This is scheduled to be on June the 2nd. Tuesday, June the 2nd was the scheduled date for this. This is the last regular lecture. We'll have a review at the second half of lecture 18. So lecture 17, two sections, lecture 18. Section 10.5 on proportions, probably the more important section in the chapter. We used to cover 10.2. That's no longer covered. It's very similar to 10.3, but 10.3 is just more useful, and we'll explain why in a little while. Okay, so here we are with the introductory slide. We're going to be doing estimation and hypothesis testing. Two populations, specifically the means. Here's the opening example. Which toothpaste do you use? Well, I'm not conducting a survey, but they are looking at loyalty. Are you a loyal user of this toothpaste? Would you ever switch to another toothpaste? Many of us never switch from one brand to another brand of a product. Okay, that's certainly one way to do it, brand loyalty. But how do we find which of the two toothpastes has more loyal users? Say you have Colgate versus Crest, something along those lines. In other words, how do we test that one toothpaste has a higher percentage of its users who would switch to the other toothpaste? That's kind of lack of loyalty, kind of two sides of the same coin. And so what we'll be talking about in 10.1, the first half of the lecture, it's just a continuation of chapter 9, but we've got two populations. The difference between two populations, either these two populations are close together or they're far apart. Sometimes we're looking for one to be greater than the other or less than the other. We'll start off with something we're not going to use a lot, but we're going to at least talk about independence versus dependent samples. And then we'll talk about mean standard deviation sampling distribution of the difference of the sample means. And then we'll try to do interval estimation about the difference in the population means, and we'll even do some hypothesis testing about the difference of the population means. Let's get going. Two samples, and we've done this kind of thing before, but we're going to talk about two samples. It's the only difference between chapter 10 and chapter 9. When we draw two samples from two populations, they're independent. That means that one sample's selection does not affect the selection of the other sample from the second population. They have no connection, no real connection. But if there is a connection, they're called dependent. And we'll talk a little bit about this in the beginning of this particular lecture. So maybe we want to estimate the difference between the mean salaries of all male and all female executives. To do so, we draw two samples, one from male executives, the other from female executives. And these samples would be independent because they're drawn from two different populations. And as far as we can tell, the samples have no effect on each other. So that's certainly the case. However, on the other example we have, well, if we wanted to find the difference between the mean weights of all participants before and after a weight loss program. So to do this, we take 40 participants and measure their weights before and after the completion of this program. It's the same 40 people. And that's an example of two dependent samples. Sometimes I've heard of, people who are engaged or twins or people in the same family, cousins. Sometimes those are also known as dependent as well. But if you have the same people, of course they're dependent. So, I've tried to fill in some of the missing pieces that they seem to always drop as I transfer these slides. But here we have three conditions for the sampling distribution of X bar 1 minus X bar 2. Why they couldn't just say that, I'm not sure. They just couldn't use the symbols. So there it is. We're going to have the samples independent because there's too many issues for dependency. That's also found in chapter 10. We're not going to be covering that. I think that's 10.4. I've never covered that one. Standard deviations of the two populations are known. That lets us use Z. And 10.3, we're not going to have that advantage, I guess you could say. 10.3, we're not going to have them known, and we'll be using the T distribution at that point. But for now, we have at least one of the following two conditions are fulfilled. Both samples are large. That is, the first and the second, N1 and N2, have to be at least 30. Now, if either one of these are small, that is less than 30, then they must both be from normal populations, and they would have to indicate that. They're not going to say that one's, you know, 29 and they forgot to say what it was. That's just not going to happen. Typically, you just see larger N's. Or happen to have one that isn't, then they must use the word normal, and normal for both, by the way, even the large population. So then in the sampling distribution of the difference of the means is approximately normally distributed, close enough, we can go ahead and use the normal. So here's a brief sketch, a rough sketch of what's going on. We're talking about the means, the differences of the means, and so often this is set equal to zero. Can't say that officially right here, but if we are sampling all the little x bar ones and x bar twos, then they start to form a sampling distribution where maybe one's larger than the other over here, or maybe one's smaller than the other over there. Maybe it's zero right in the center. And we have a standard deviation that another slide does go into a little bit of detail on. I would just simply have this handy. Sampling distribution and the mean standard deviation, same topic. We have the sampling distribution of the difference of the sample means is normal with the following situations. Mu of this is exactly what you might have got from just guessing. The mu 1 minus mu 2, that's what the sample means are trying to get at, except now we're actually trying to get a difference of the samples. And the major difference here is that we have the standard deviation. That's not at all obvious, but in a way, these are like the sum of the variances that have been added and square rooted to kind of get you back to the standard deviations. Okay, so in using the normal distribution, a certain confidence interval for the difference of the means starts off with the difference in the sample means. That's very important. I think an easy way to see it. That's also known as a point estimate. We'll get to that. And then we have to put in Z times sigma. This is looking exactly the same as before, except sometimes we have more numbers to carry with us. So we have to calculate what sigma is, and whether you put that into one big formula or not. When I was learning it, we used to just put them in these big formulas, but now the thinking is that probably better to go one step at a time, and that's really up to you. So anyway, as we are hinting at from earlier, the difference in the sample means is the point estimator of mu 1 minus mu 2. So we just simply use the x-bars as pinch hitters for the actual mu's, because we probably don't know the actual mu's. All we have are the sample means. So we start with that. So here's an actual example. According to this survey, between the years 2014-2012, the average premium for health insurance here was $16,000-something in 2014 and $15,000-something in 2012. Yeah, it increased over the two-year period. Not surprising. That's very typical. And we happen to have random samples of 250 and 200. They're both greater than 30. That's fine. I mean, an ideal situation is when the samples happen to be the same, but we frequently do not quite get that. And we also have some standard deviations. There's the 2014, here's the 2012, and we will use all of those numbers coming up. So mu1 and mu2 are the actual population means for each of the years 2014 and 2012. Notice these are not necessarily in numerical or a time order. 2014 is going with the mu1, 2012 is going with mu2, so it's not really going on a timeline. However, this does have the advantage of making the difference positive, which many people find to be an advantage. There wouldn't be any big problem with you switching the two numbers. Standard deviation wouldn't care at all, and you would just have a negative difference instead of a positive difference, or vice versa. That's not going to matter. The idea is to see how far away it is from zero. It's really more important. And yes, this book seems to just love the 97 percenter. I am not going to use that on the test, even though we've seen it too many times on these slides. Well, the point estimate is the easy part. At least get this one out of the way. We start off with the number from 14 and the number from 12, so to speak. We find that it's gone up over the two-year period by $1,089. That's informative right there and very, very easy to do. Here's the standard deviation. Now this one is basically kind of a weighted average, and so you put all the numbers in as we indicated before, and it's, you know, a little bit of number crunching, and then you get really about $196.12. They have carried a lot more decimals. I guess it's safer, of course, to use more decimals versus, say, rounding to the nearest $10 or something, which I find ridiculous. I'd go to 2 or 3 decimals when it comes to money, personally. Anyway, here's the full-on calculation from the formula. We found already the 1,089, so they're just kind of repeating themselves. We'd seen this before, that Z in this special case was 2.17. You're not going to have to worry about using that again, not on my tests at least. And then we calculated the standard error, so to speak, and then we found out the margin of error is over $425. And as we add and subtract it, which is easy to do, yes, we do want you to add and subtract the numbers. Full credit is not given unless I see the numbers given. And round to the same level, pennies is always good with money. And be sure there are 2 digits on each side, 2 decimals on each side. So now we're 97% confident that we can state the difference between the premiums from 2014 minus 2012 is between a minimum of $663 and a maximum of over $1,514. That's quite a range of numbers. This is not a very precise confidence interval. It does have that kind of a weakness. I will make a notice, though, we'll tell you that they're both greater than zero, which means it's not likely at all that they have stayed the same over the last 2 years. I guess that's kind of obvious, but I just had to restate the obvious. Okay, so we could test an alternative hypothesis that the means of two populations are different. And we have 2 different ways of saying it, and I do not care which one you use. You could simply say that the first mean is not equal to the second mean. Or, if you'd rather bundle them together and compare them to zero, subtract them out, and if they're not equal, the difference cannot equal zero. The second one has the advantage of being graphable. I mean, what you're doing is you're really graphing that kind of thing. They already showed you mu1 minus mu2. However, if you happen to list your hypotheses in the alternate format, that does not matter. We figure you can make a leap of faith and still do an equivalent diagram. What we're not going to do is have 2 separate normal curves. That's way too difficult. Nope, not going to do it here. That's for another class. Okay, so now let's take a look at the next one. These are just kind of a catalog of what we could have. If we have the mean of the first population is greater than the mean of the second, then we could say that mu1 is greater than mu2, or if you prefer somehow, you could take the difference and make sure that difference is greater than zero. Parentheses are optional. And I do not care which one you use. The first one is certainly briefer. The second one is more directly graphable. Okay, if we talk about less than, so we're really kind of repeating ourselves, either we have mu1 less than mu2, or the difference of the two means would be less than zero, a negative difference. That would be graphable, be over on the left side of the curve. Okay, now we have a test statistic Z for the difference of the sample means, which is all you're going to be given. And so the value of the test statistic, which is Z, because sigma is known, simply would take the difference of the sample means, and then we are going to let this second part of the denominator always equal zero in our class. And sometimes I have to say this 4 or 5 different sections. Here we're only going to see it 2 or 3 times. And just zero out the second half of the numerator. You do not have to worry about it. People that drag that around and think about it for 5 or 10 minutes just aren't getting it. We're setting that equal to zero, so you don't have to worry about it. Now, of course, we still have to explain the denominator, but that's coming up. So let's take a look. This example, we're going to test at the 1% significance level whether the two population means that we just talked about are different. And I just kind of gave you a clue about that confidence interval not including zero. That's typically a very good indicator. In fact, often it's directly tied in. And so let's take a look. Here we have the hypotheses. This one is set regarding the zero. This is kind of the graphical method. And once again, I do not have a preference as to which one you want to use. But I would always put the equals up in the HO, and I'll be able to know people who've been listening to my lectures by those that follow that lesson versus those that are getting it from some other source, which is not really what I have in mind at all. And then we have the mu1 minus mu2 not equal to zero. So here we simply have not different versus different. Graphical too. Graphable. population standard deviations are known, both samples are large, so we have no problem using the normal distribution. Alpha is 0.01. And the sign in the alternative hypothesis indicates that the test is two-tailed. And this was a not equal to sign. That's just a little bit of an error there. And so now we'd like to find out what Z would be. And this really has the advantage of being just like a 99% confidence interval. Why do I say that? Well, we've got 0.005 at each tail. They've split the alpha in half. And 1 minus 0.01 is 0.99. That's what that is. So this should look familiar to you. 99% CI. We did not care whether you use the two decimal. Maybe there's a three decimal version if you want to use that. But 2.58 minus 2.58 is what you get. So it just happens to be the same thing as something we've already talked about. And here's a better picture than what I drew. Okay, now we do some calculations. And so sigma, the standard error will be, of course, the sigma 1 squared plus over N1 plus sigma 2 squared over N2. And they basically show you some of the details here. Notice we have zapped out that second half of the numerator there. And that's where that zero came in, from H0. Not a coincidence they call it H0. It so often has to do with zero. And they'd already calculated the $196 and basically 12 cents. More decimals does give you more accuracy. However, this is very large value of Z. It's, as we go back just a slide, 5.55 is way the heck over here. And so we're definitely in the rejection region. We reject HO. This is just way too far out of bounds for it to be plausible at all. Off the table. Anything off 3.50 minus 3.50, those are off the table, and I'm avoiding those on the test. So anyway, to reiterate, because the value of the test statistic 5.55 falls in the rejection region, we do reject HO. If you like to say prefer HA, that's fine. I don't care. But we conclude the average annual premiums were different. What a surprise. And now we talk a little bit more about independent versus dependent samples. This is a nice picture, I suppose. And we do have to have independence in this chapter. If you somehow suspect it, like on web work or maybe one of the homework problems, I doubt it, but maybe on one of the homework problems, dependence, if they're tied together, like the second diagram, that's not independent anymore. And that runs into trouble. If you really have to know about it, read 10.4. Okay, so. Which ones are independent, which ones are dependent. Triglyceride levels of 70 patients, and that's the first sample, and then we take the same 70 patients using a drug for 6 months to lower the triglycerides, and that obviously is dependent. They can be paired with each patient. However, in the next example, we take scores of 38 adult males on a psychological screening test for attention deficit hyperactivity disorder. And then we also have 30 adult females. They don't seem to be paired up in any way. This does appear to be independent. Okay, so now we take another look at the null hypothesis, H0, and it usually says there's no difference. That's what we're going to use. Occasionally they put a handicap in, such as letting mu 1 minus mu 2 equal 5 or something, and so the men have to be the women by 5 strokes at golf or some silly. We're not going to do that here. That's not for us. That's for another class. And there's no difference. Essentially, I'm just going to say let's just use equals. It is technically possible to use one of those two, but I discourage the use of those. I'm not going to give you problems that difficult that you have to worry about it, so I just discourage it, and because it usually opens the door to errors, which I have to charge you for. So just go ahead and use equals. Put all your emphasis on HA. Now this one, or H1, because they are the same thing, and I do not care which one you use. Different books use different H's. So this one would be true when HO is false. So if we rejected HO, then basically HA is our favorite. And this one will not contain the equal sign. It will never contain the equal sign. If I did make that clear, let's make it clear now. It'll be simply greater than, lesser than, or not equal to. Okay, so here we have the three types of hypothesis tests. Notice how HA or H1 is really telling you all you need to know. Let me just cross out these A's, make ones out of them. Not that I have to worry about that. But notice how HO always looks the same. But yeah, mu1 and mu2 are supposed to be about the same, hardly any difference. So now we just put the direction down in H1, HA, and find out what's going on. And if you'd rather set it equal to zero, you have the right to do that. We do not really care. Okay, so to perform a z-test for the difference between two population means when the samples are independent, the following conditions are necessary, and this is just a review of what we had, so I'll go through this kind of quickly. Population standard deviations are known, samples are randomly selected, yes, they're independent, yes, they're either normal or at least 30. Usually they just go for the larger samples, but if not, they'll say normal. And so when these conditions are met, sampling distribution for the difference of the sample means is normal distribution, approximately normal. And there's a little bit more reading here if you care to take a look at this. And there's another small mistake. That's x1 bar minus x2 bar. And so they basically just taken a look at the means and separated them out. And that's all there is to it. And they even show how the variances could be put in. But you do not have to worry about, you know, deriving these or anything like that. But that's previously used information. Okay, a little bit of scratch work on the bottom of the screen. Apologize for that. So the two sample z-tests will be used when we're looking for, you know, various questions about the two population means. Well, are they the same? Are they one greater than the other? One less than the other? And so we go through this checklist that we've already talked about. And large sample sizes typically, or perhaps both normal. And then the test statistic is x1 bar minus x2 bar, and the standardized test is, well, not fully written down there, but let me fill in a little bit more. This part doesn't count. Yeah, so that's all rehash what we've already done. Let's finally get to some examples here. And they're going through the checklist again, so once again, I'll go through this kind of quickly. State HO, state HA, or H1. Has to be stated. You cannot just skip that step. You have to list them both. Identify alpha. It'll be identified. Determine the critical values. Notice we are using the critical value method. With a Z distribution, you could easily find a p-value from the table. That's your decision. Just answer the question as to what is your favorite hypothesis and why. So hopefully the quiz will give you a little bit of practice with that. And there's not much pressure on the quiz, I don't believe. So we do have the rejection regions, and we have our standardized test statistic. Essentially, it's just the difference of the x's over the sigma. Skip that last part. That's just zero. Just skip that last part. I'm not using it. Make a decision to reject or maybe not reject the null hypothesis, and interpret the decision. So be prepared to comment on your scenario. Okay, here's an example. A credit card watchdog group claims that there is a difference in the mean credit card debts of households in California and Florida. The results of a random survey of 250 households from each state, so that's good, same size, they're both larger than 30. Show on the left, of course, they're independent, and then we also have our sigmas given. A little bit more variability in California than in Florida. Do the results support the group's claim? And of course, all they're looking for is a difference. They didn't say one was more than the other. They're just seeing, are these states different in this respect? And just looking at the raw totals, I only see about $150 between the two. So of course, we can do what we need to do. The sigmas are known, samples are random. We have large sample sizes. We're using the z-test. And the claim is that there is a difference. And so that's in the alternative hypothesis. And by default, HO always looks the same. And because the test is a two-tailed test, the level of significance is 0.05, we have what really works out to be a 95% confidence interval. Lots of coincidences here. We split the 0.05 in half for the alphas. They just didn't happen to mention it. So this is like a 95% CI, the ultra-popular one that has the very popular Zs, plus and minus 1.96. Dare say you're going to be seeing that a little bit more. Okay, so the standardized test statistic is simply Z equals the difference in the X bars over the standard error. And yeah, that second part is always zeroed out, so you can just basically ignore it. And we do find our 150 in the numerator, as I said, they just didn't show it. And I'm not quite sure what the denominator is, they didn't show quite as much detail, but here Z is equal to 1.85, which is sort of borderline high. However, I don't think that's going to be large enough. See, I like this type of graphic particularly well because it shows the lines in the sand, which they call Z0. That could be Z critical value, if you'd like. So a possible alternative notation, ZCV. And this could be Z data. There's lots of ways to do it. But usually, it's obvious from your work what you're doing. So even if you don't happen to help me out with that, I can almost always figure out what you're trying to do. So I wouldn't worry about that exceptionally a lot. But anyway, 1.85 didn't quite cross over. So it's still on the light side of things. We like HO. We fail to reject HO. The double negative means we prefer HO. So we don't see much difference. It was close, but not enough to be official about it, especially not at a 5% level of rarity, level of significance. We just don't have it. P-value might have been, 0.06, something like that. It looks kind of rare, but not rare enough. Okay, so here's another one, comparing states again. Average daily cost of meals and lodging for vacationing in Texas. They're saying it might be less in Texas than it is in Virginia. Well, Texas is a big state. And I suppose there's a lot of big cities, a lot of small cities. Never been to Virginia, though. But anyway, standard deviation looks like it's a little tighter in Texas. That's surprising. A little bit wider in Virginia, although they are very close. And then we see about a $6 difference between the Texas average and the Virginia average. But both of these have small n's. They're both small n's. They're both less than 30. 25 and 20, they're both less than 30. However, never fear, normally distributed is written down. Can't say as I'm very surprised by that. Should kind of expect it. Anyway, we do have the known sigmas. The samples are random, they're independent, and normally distributed. And of course, we can use the z-test. And the claim, to say it again, is the average daily cost of meals and lodging for vacationing in Texas is less than that same daily cost in Virginia. So this less than sign says it all. That's the most important thing on the entire list. That's what you're looking for. What is in HA or H1? And yes, if you'd like to call that a claim, fine. It's just adds another dimension to that. I so often don't really worry about the claim, but I could say in certain problems, test the claim that. So I'm certainly going to reserve the right to use it. But I don't always use that. Now, this came out kind of poorly, and I find it a little bit hard to follow. But if you've been using the TI-84 Plus, there are sections in the back of each chapter that can guide you through the steps needed for your TI. Now, I know this is a terrible mess here, so please look at the pages in the back of Chapter 10. And as long as you list your calculator steps, I encourage you to use the graphing calculator. But you must tell me what you did. Don't leave me guessing, because I don't really care to guess what you did. And here's a better picture. It has our z-score. This is really minus 0.87, very close to zero. And here's your p-value of 0.91914 or so. In fact, they rounded to four decimals here. So we found a value that had 19.1% chance of happening due to random chance. The value you got, or even a more extreme value, was at 0.1914, and that's not very rare compared to any alpha that we would ever use. That's not rare. That means HO wins, because we found something that just is kind of common. It'll happen almost 20% on its own due to random chance. And this part seems to be, okay, it's just a summary of what we just did. So rejection region was less than minus 2.33, but we weren't close. We got minus 0.87, so yes, you failed to reject null. You like HO. Not much difference there at the 1% level. You can't support the claim that the one state is less than the other state. All right, so that's the end of the first section. Let's go to the second one, and we do skip 10.2. We'll go straight to 10.3. Here, basically the sigmas are unknown, and we have no reason ever to assume that they're equal. So let's just go ahead and make the safe assumption that they're unequal. That cuts out 10.2 right there, and it gives us something else to look at that would be more useful to us. 10.2 is for those that really split hairs on this stuff. Okay, I will have to say this, that the degrees of freedom will be the lesser of, and this is something that only you guys who are watching these shows will actually pay attention to, because it's not in your book, but I want you to pick the DF to be the smaller of either N1 minus 1 or N2 minus 1. So the easy way to do that is to pick your smaller sample size, unless it's a tie, and subtract 1. That's your degrees of freedom. There is a formula. It's a big waste of time. Do not use it. However, if you have a TI such as an 84, it uses a formula like that. Maybe it's not exactly the same, but it's something just like it. And they will go ahead and calculate your degrees of freedom for you. If you're clearly using a calculator, and you give me calculator steps, that's how I know, then that's an exception. But somebody who just digs a formula out and wants to spend 30 minutes on the final working on a degrees of freedom formula, that's just not what I have in mind. I'm trying to give you shortcuts. And so please take them. Those of you who are taking them, I do appreciate very much. But anyway, two samples are independent. Standard deviations are unknown and unequal. Typically, that's a very safe assumption, because you'd have to know a lot about your data to assume that they're the same. And then there is a shortcut. Sure doesn't look like a shortcut to me in 10.2, so that's why we're skipping it. And of course, just like before, both samples are large, but then if either one are small, then they both must be normal. So for those that fall between the cracks, advanced statistics is waiting for you to find all kinds of other checklists to follow. But we're only going to hit the highlights. Okay, so the estimate of the standard deviation of x-bar 1 minus x-bar 2, I had these all corrected and then it kind of erased it, but there you go. That's what we're trying to say here. And so we're going to try to get the standard deviation of the difference of the means. Now, because we don't know sigma, everything is S now. S of the difference of the means, sampling distribution. So everything is S. Of course, it's going to lead to T. S always goes with T, and sigma always goes with Z. And here is another confidence interval, looking just like all the other confidence intervals. If you step back and look at the big picture, this is just going to be the difference of the means. I like to put parentheses. That's optional. And you have a value of T that you have to find, and then you also have to calculate the standard deviation. So we've got three things to look for. And use the easy formula for degrees of freedom, please. Unless, of course, your calculator is doing it for you. So here's an example. According to a prior example, which we did not cover, a sample of 15 one-pound jars of coffee of brand 1 showed that the mean amount of caffeine in these jars is 80 milligrams per jar, standard deviation of 5. So there's another sample of 12 one-pound coffee jars versus 15. These are both small samples. And that gave a mean amount of caffeine down to 77, standard deviation of 6. So 80 and 77 are the two big numbers here, and they look kind of close. So let's take a look. They all they want is a confidence interval. I'm not doing hypothesis testing yet, so it's typically slightly easier to do the confidence intervals. So we want to find the difference between the mean amount of caffeine and the two jars. And because we had small sample sizes, yes, they are giving us the way out. We assume that they are both normal. And yeah, we're also going to safely assume they're not equal. That's kind of like the go-to. Okay, here's the calculation first for the standard deviation with all those decimal places. So they put in the 5 from the S1, they square it. They put in 15 from the N1, divide it out. And then you put in the S2, they gave you the standard deviation. Actually, they want the variance and then the formula. So 6 squared, these are actually pretty easy numbers. That's 25 over 15 plus 36 over 12. That number's actually just a 3, and that's what, a 1.67. Well, anyway, I trust them. And even if you only put 4 or 5 decimals down, I guess that's okay. So that's 2.16, essentially. So here is the confidence interval, and this is a T distribution, and they did pick the smaller of the degrees of freedom. So we had 12 as our smaller sample, so pick the smaller one, 12 minus 1, which is 11. So they looked up for this scenario, T with 11 degrees of freedom and a confidence interval, which is 2 tail, I will give you the table that labels it all for you. So feel free to use that. So they found it from the table, 2.08, and they put the zero in. Notice 3 decimals for T. Yes, that just shows good form. It shows you're paying attention. So little things like that do matter. Some people don't really follow that. Well, anyway, you grind that all out, and we find a pretty wide margin of error, around 4.5. And as you subtract it, it's between around -1.5 and 7.5. I notice that zero is included. It typically means included. I misspelled included. So typically means that there really is not much difference between the two. But that's not the question right now, is it? So hypothesis testing. Test statistic, T. So what we'll do here is we'll take the difference in the means, x1 bar minus x2 bar, subtract away this zero at the end. That's always going to be zero, so you may ignore that. If you're writing formulas down, don't even bother with that part. Or put a zero in there if you think you might forget. Yes, you'd have to calculate S. Okay, so the value of mu1 minus mu2, as I just said, is substituted from the HO null hypothesis, which is H0. And the S is calculated as explained earlier. So let's take a look at a different example. In this case, we've got 14 cans of brand 1 diet soda, gave the mean number of calories per can of 23 and standard deviation of 3. Boy, it seems like either they've got 0 calories or they've got 150 calories. They used to have these diet 10 sodas that had 10 calories, but I don't know of any that have 20. Maybe the Arnold Palmers that have the iced tea and the lemonade or something. Maybe those have low calorie. I don't know. Anyway, we only have 14 cans of one, 16 of the other. I'll bet normal's in the offing here. And in the second brand, we have 25 calories per can, standard deviation of 4 calories. And they'd like to test, this is now a hypothesis test, at the 1% significance level where the mean calories per can of diet soda are different. Difference. So there's no direction implied. These are, I think they're finally a little bit easier when it comes to comparing two populations. You may as well just say different, and that way you can be neutral about it. And the calories are, of course, normally distributed. Not surprisingly, did that. The standard deviations are not equal. So here's how we could set up the hypotheses with regards to zero. And if you'd rather just say that mu1 equals mu2 or mu1 is not equal to mu2, that's faster. I don't blame you. So I'll go ahead and give that one equal time. Either they are the same or they're not the same. You're technically not graphing that, but that doesn't matter too much. So same old stuff. We do have the two samples are independent. Standard deviations are unknown. That's the main thing. And they're both normally distributed, but remember, normally means Z or T. Doesn't always mean Z. I've had a lot of students think, oh, it must be Z. No, T is a special version of Z. In fact, there are others as well. But we do use the T distribution here because the populations, the standard deviations, are unknown. These are the S's. This is code for saying, yes, we have S1. Yes, we have S2. We don't know sigma. So T is our backup plan. All right, so the not equal sign means it's two-tailed, and yes, you do cut the 0.01 in half to get it down to 0.005, and this should look familiar as like a 99% confidence interval, just inside out. However, we're talking T here, and these are not popular numbers, but as you look at the degrees of freedom, which was the smaller of the two, I don't happen to remember what that was. I think it was, 14? So you'd have degrees of freedom 13, and then you'd look up this particular either two-tailed interval here, provided it says two-tail, or you could look at right tail and do it that way. Pick one. They're equivalent. They'll be the same column. And you have your two critical values of T, a little bit further out than most of the Z's are. That's the way T goes. And here's a nice picture that shows you all the regions and everything. And I found that lots of A students do this kind of thing. Maybe they're not perfect every time, but yet they try to tell me what they're trying to do, which is always a good thing, no matter what you do with this stuff, whether you use it on a daily basis or maybe once a month, I don't know, but if you're clear with whomever you're talking to, that's what matters. Okay, so here we continue our example with some of the numbers we saw earlier, and basically you just plug them in. Of course, the calculator does a lot of this for you, and if you will show me your calculator steps, you can save some time. but need to see the steps. There are a lot of people who don't like to show their steps, and guess what? I don't like to give a lot of points for that either. So it's a fair trade, and I think most rational people do see it. That is a fair trade. And yes, you are saving time if you purchased the calculator and took the time to learn it. But doesn't mean that a lot of you can't do well. You can. You just have to grind this stuff out. And we got a standard deviation of around 1.2817. We do cross out that second part all the time. We're always subtracting zero. And yes, we only have a difference of around 2. Negative 2 is in the numerator over around 1.28, etc. So this is a value of negative 1.560. I don't think that's far enough over. In fact, if we take a look at the picture, it falls in the non-rejection region. I don't think they did it again, so let's go back here. Minus 1.560, remember this is T, three decimals, that's what we got, and that says we are in the, not the dark side, we're in the light side. Do not reject HO. We like HO. We prefer HO, in fact. Not strong enough. Fail to reject null hypothesis. In other words, no difference. There's no difference in the middle. They're equal. Here's another way to do it. Put the equal in the middle, and here's the not equals on either side. And if it's left or right, you can just change it if you wish. But this is just a brief sketch of what's going on sign-wise. And here's a flow chart. I don't know if this is helpful or not, but if you have both standard deviations known and they're both normal or greater than 30, you're in 10.1 and you're using the z-test. I've already crossed off some paths here that you're not going to be doing here. For example, not using the z or t, well, okay, not happening here, so forget that. Are both populations normal or both sample sizes at least 30? Well, if that's a no, then you'd also be stuck, so that's a dead end as well. Not going to do that one. Well, the population variance is equal. That's 10.2. Yeah, it's a slightly different test. No, we're not covering it. 10.2 is not covered here. So that's for trivia. And then when the populations are considered unequal, which is like the standard, because if you don't know, you cannot assume they're equal. It's always better to safely assume that they're unequal. And here's what we just talked about in 10.3. And notice, finally in print, you do see the smaller of the two degrees of freedom. Do not waste your time with the formula. Okay, so as we try to go through some of this other stuff, we look and make sure that the sigmas are unknown. We do have the S's, that's the other way to say it, and we either have normal or both greater than or equal to 30 for the sample sizes. And so this is just a rehash of what we already did, so we can state the HO and the HA or H1. Specify the level of significance, so we identify alpha. Yes, that's going to be listed every time. Degrees of freedom. Yes, please use the smaller of the two, N1 minus 1 or N2 minus 1. It's just easier to find the smaller sample size and subtract 1. That's all you have to do. It's a very, very good approximation, commonly used. Determine the critical values from the table. Determine the rejection regions. Sketch is always very much enjoyed by me. And then the two sample t-test. And this is just what we did before, so I don't want to waste a lot of time on this. And yeah, that's just the same old formula, skipping the second half of the numerator as always. Make a decision and be prepared to comment on it. Basically, all you do is you look at your preferred hypothesis and write it up, put it into words. That's mostly what it is. Sometimes there's more. If there's claims involved, you might want to address the claim, especially if we happen to ask you to, if we ask you directly, is the claim, what do you feel about the claim? Should you reject it or not? That kind of thing. So interpret the decision. That's what I'm trying to get at. Number 9, in the context of the claim. And so a couple more examples. The results of a math test, state math test, for random samples of students taught by two different teachers at the same school as shown below. Can you conclude that there's a difference, that's all it says is difference, in the mean test scores for the students of the two teachers? And alpha is only 0.10. And we're going to go ahead and assume that it's normal, because I also see that the sample sizes are very small. And yeah, I see a small difference between the two. I see that one minus that one looks like about 14. And 14 out of 400-something doesn't look too much like too much of a difference to me, but I could be wrong. So the standard deviations are unknown, of course, and all the rest of the stuff falls into place. So we're using a t-test. like we are in this part of the situation. So it really just boils down to, do you know sigmas or do you not know sigmas? Because the rest of it will be taken care of for you. So the difference is a two-tail test, not a direction going, and so many two-tailed, from two parameters, so many of them are two-tail tests. Not all of them, but it seems like we get a higher percentage of those. So we have those ideas there, and the claim is that there is a difference, by the way. And the smaller sample size was 8. Please use 8 - 1 = 7. Very easy. Test is two-tail test, and yes, we have alpha 0.10 as we saw earlier. And as you look them up, degrees of freedom 7, alpha 0.10, and a two-tailed test, and you find the intersection there is that all you see is the 1.895, but it really means both of them, for it's two-tailed, and then we have the rejection regions as well. When you go into the tails give you the rejection regions relative, of course, to HO. And so here is a calculation for you. Using the formula, I'll slip in this plus sign here, and let's go ahead and put that in. And we found the difference here. This says a lot right here. They should have highlighted that more. We have 14 divided by whatever that is. A little less detail on these examples. And so we go ahead and find out the denominator. It takes a little bit more time to do that. Just, you know, jot stuff down. And now your T, 0.922, this zero always says that zero is H0 is the winner. The null hypothesis is your preferred hypothesis. It always works for T and Z. In fact, it usually bends a little further over away from the zero. But if you've got a zero, you know you've got H0 because you're in the center. Maybe not the direct center, but yeah, that looks pretty close to the center right there, 0.922. This is one time I actually like to use the zero in front of the decimal. It's about the only time I ever do because it does make that point. It does make that point. This type of thing I don't care about, but for the Z's, I kind of do like that kind of thing. And anyway, it was not even close to the rejection region. It looks like it's about half, but of course, this is not linear. It's exponential, so it's not really a fair judge. But it's not really close to making a difference, so these two teachers are pretty close together, really. And that's the idea, to reject, fail to reject the null hypothesis. In other words, we like HO. I'll go ahead and use the vernacular here. We prefer HO, especially at the 10% level of significance. That's the one that gives even more territory to HA, and we just didn't get it. Didn't get it at all. So they're just not different. They're pretty much the same. That's the end of the slideshow, so I'll leave it on here for a little bit longer. So now we're down to the end of lecture 17. Yes, there will be a quiz right before the final. I'm sorry about the distraction for some of you. And you'll have to try to take that quiz, especially if you're in the earlier class. You want to get that out of the way so you can study for your final. And quiz is primarily for extra credit. We do want you to do them. We find that when there's a lot less pressure to work on the problems, that you might learn from the what pressure there is. But some people make a big deal about, no, I want to make up and all that. There are no makeups on these. They're not meant to be that kind of thing. And if you can't get Blackboard to work on the quizzes, how would you possibly do the final? And that's going to be essential for you to use Blackboard on the final, and we're not going to be able to get around that. So web work and the written homework, yeah, that's all going to be part of it. We'll want you to do those in a timely way, but studying for the final is the big part. And we'll have much more to say about the final next time, but we'll talk about the options that people have. I'm not at liberty to speak of them right now, but we'll talk about that kind of thing. But Blackboard will be a big part of the final exam, that's for sure. Okay, I've rambled on long enough, and it's almost 100 degrees outside as I record this, so I'm going to go ahead and take it easy and maybe grade some more homework. And meanwhile, study hard. Please email me. Please visit the office hours. Make sure your Zoom camera works. Good time to check it is during the office hour. You do have to have the Zoom camera on, or I cannot really give you credit on your exam. So please be sure you've got that. And almost all of you are fine with that. Okay, talk to you soon.